You may have noticed by now that I'm a fan of comic book movies. Not only because I'm a fan of comic books themselves, but because I find the forms and mechanisms of the genre endlessly fascinating. It is the promised land of the cinema, predictably delivered serialized adventures starring colorful characters and dangerous locations that also happen to be the most profitable productions of the Hollywood industry, and among some of its most critically acclaimed work in recent years. Previous industry standards held that you could not be critically acclaimed low culture that saw profits in the multiples of your competitors while gaining Oscar noms for your 21st film in a series. You can be some of these things, such as low culture, profitable, and in your 21st production, or critically acclaimed and profitable with an Oscar nom, but you can't be all of them at once. Comic book movies have broken and rewritten the rules of Hollywood, recreating the industry around themselves, and in some few attempts, in reflection of themselves. But what did they destroy and replace? And what had that system they replaced itself replaced? Why does all of this seem so familiar? Well, partners, thereby lays a tale. A tale of rugged pioneers and westward expansion, of valiant cowpokes and crooked desperados, whitewashing and blacklisting, the rise and fall of a new America, and what came after. This here's a brief history of the Western.
Them tumbling down, pledging their love to the ground. Lonely but free I'll be found, drifting along with the tumbling tumbleweeds. Cares of the past are behind.
On December 1st, 1903, audiences at New York's Hoover Museum, a dime show theater that would display exhibits, live shows, and the technical marvel of the moving picture, witnessed the debut of Edwin S. Porter's The Great Train Robbery, and were blown away. No pun intended. While the rumors of frightened viewers stampeding out of the theater during the show are considered to be merely urban legend, the film itself captivated critics and ticket holders alike, hailed as the best work of the medium to date, and a sign that the great potential this still young art form held. With a budget of just $150, worth about $4,000 today, Porter gave audiences 12 of the most exciting minutes of their lives, using a series of engaging action scenes to tie together the loose concept of a plot involving, you guessed it, a train robbery. The big draw, however, was the final shot, an unrelated to the actual plot, first-person shot by the film's big bad, played by Justice D. Barnes. While the multimedia-saturated landscape we live in today presents us with images and perspectives we likely would never have considered or seen on our own on a daily basis, this was the first time for the majority of the audience to experience seeing someone shoot a gun at them, and this one simple stunt both thrilled and hooked the audience for more. Film's great addiction to the Western had just begun. But it wasn't America's first hit of cowboys, outlaws, and outdated ethnic stereotypes, which had been the primary fictional landscape of the country during the previous century, as the nation pushed out past the eastern boundaries of Appalachia and into the untouched frontier. Untouched so long as you ignore the ancient cultures of hundreds of thousands of First Nations people. The Western genre of fiction and adventure had already long reigned over American culture, in the form of dime store novels, popular plays, hit songs, and traveling reviews, such as Buffalo Bill's Wild West Show, and in larger-than-life celebrities, such as Annie Oakley and Wild Bill Hickok, seen here in shorts from 1894. The West was the quintessential American existence, an aggressively individualistic scramble for wealth and survival, but told with flair and showmanship. And it had captivated not only people on the East Coast, but spread the myth of America across the globe, bringing countless immigrants seeking their fortune in the Great Frontier. It was only natural, then, that when film technology caught up to the storytelling aspirations of the early adopters, the genre would quickly become a pillar of the industry for decades to come. For almost a quarter of a century, even before talking pictures were developed, Westerns ruled at the box office. D.W. Griffith's The Massacre, Tom Mix's The Cowboy Millionaire, Six Shooter Justice, The Knickerbocker Buckaroo, Spoilers of the West, The Virginian, hundreds of Westerns were produced both on the Edison-controlled East Coast and Hollywood's rebellious West, flooding the market with easy-to-produce, formulaic but action-packed films that audiences, during and after the Great War, devoured with zeal, visiting a fantasy world of simpler times. The nature of Westerns themselves made them uniquely cheap to produce. They are period pieces, yet require clothing still worn by some and easily available at that time. They require horses, but horses were still a major part of transportation, and so both the horses themselves and the actors capable of riding them were in plentiful supply. Their sets were often reusable and minimal, typically instead requiring extensive filming outside, either on cheaply rented ranches or free public property. And the formula these films followed would still be recognizable even to young viewers today. The Western helped to establish the cookie-cutter, cartoonish conflict that would become a shorthand of storytelling ever since, with the white hat paragon of virtue and the nefarious black hat villain, a necessary visual distinction made to help identify characters on screen. Stories would often feature a heist and a chase, a deed to a mine, a saloon brawl, racist displays of First Nations, and a farmer's daughter, all mixed and matched and varied for budget. They were also well-suited for pre-Hays Code filmmaking, with the wild gunplay and steamy situations taking full advantage of the lack of censorship.
While Cap Willie, looking mighty pale, was standing by the sheriff's side. And when that sheriff said, "I'm sending you to jail," Wildcat raised his head and cried, "Oh, give me land, lots of land under starry skies above. Don't fence me in."
While When the Talkies Arrived, Westerns took a hit as musicals rode the new novelty of sound into its own foundational part of Hollywood, though not before birthing the camp nonsense subgenre called the singing cowboy, most notable for the career of the man later named the King of the Cowboys, Roy Rogers. This new challenge only forced the studios to allow the Western to grow, creating more complex characters and more layered and nuanced conflicts and situations. Like most other silent film stars, the quiet cowboys found themselves quickly abandoned for a new breed of rootin' tootin' hero, the Golden Age leading man. Actors like Gary Cooper, who shot to stardom with a 1929 remake of The Virginian. Former silent era stuntman Buck Jones, who, after a career of over 50 Westerns, was one of the 492 victims of the tragic Coconut Grove fire of 1942. And a young John Wayne, a Fox Film Corporation prop boy who was chosen by Raoul Walsh, the guy who plays John Wilkes Booth in Birth of a Nation, to star in 1930's The Big Trail, a film about trying not to die on the Oregon Trail. These movies about opportunity and freedom, law and order, progress and the homestead, helped the American public distract themselves from the hardships of the Great Depression. And come the Second Great War, they were a foundational part of the American patriotic identity, reaffirming the cultural ideal of justice, determination, and integrity. Both the American public and the Western genre would come out of that conflict changed, both having become superpowers in their own rights. But we'll talk more about that in part two. Until then.
Don't fence me in. I'm the roving kind, so if you don't mind, all that I can say is, come on, Trigger, let's be on our way.